Good afternoon, friends. I am Dr. Anna, Associate Professor in Al-Azhar Medical College, Tuticorin. Today, I thought I will share a few learning videos related to the subject of pediatrics. This will be of use to both the undergraduates and to the postgraduates. Today, I am going to discuss one of the major topics, that is Down syndrome. Down syndrome, as you all know, is one of the most common chromosomal abnormality seen in children. Coming to the incidence, it is 1 in 733 live births. See, if you actually see the age-wise difference in the incidence of Down syndrome, in the age group of 15 to 29 years, the incidence is 1 in 1550. As the age progresses, see, in 13 to 34 it is 1 in 800, 35 to 39 it is 1 in 250, 40 to 44 it is 1 in 100, and more than 45 years it is 1 in 50. So, as you can see from the graph mentioned here, as the age of the mother increases, the risk for the development or the risk for having a baby with Down syndrome also increases. The main why it is happening is generally because of certain factors, genetics behind it. 95% cases are due to trisomy 21. Trisomy 21 happens when there is non-distinction during meiosis. Most of the cases are due to non-distinction happening during maternal meiosis part 1. And 1% is due to mosaics, and 4% cases are due to translocation. Translocation, if you get any Down syndrome baby with a carrier, so if you see offer translocation, we have to do the maternal and the paternal karyotype to understand the recurrence rate in future pregnancies. Coming to the clinical features of Down syndrome, my advice to all my students and also my colleagues are like, whenever you are studying about anything or any syndromes or any clinical thing, remember it in an order so that you will not miss out on anything. Imagine seeing a child with Down syndrome, or think of the clinical condition, think of the case, and learn in an orderly way. So first, when you are actually seeing a case of Down syndrome, first the cranial nerve system, when you are seeing the child may be hypotonic, slight height, the hypotonia may be there, there may be a poor morose reflex, and developmental delay can happen later. Then CNS, what are the craniofacial anomalies which we can see in a case of Down syndrome? That is like, if you see the head of the child, head over there will have a flat occiput, their head will tend to be small, and if you see closely, they may have three or more fontanelles with a delayed closure of fontanelles later. Coming to the eyes, or the flat occiput is very marked here. Coming to the eyes, when we see the eyes of a child with Down syndrome, you will be able to notice the upslanting of the eyes, the oblique palpebral fissure, epicanthic folds, and also brush field irises. The speckled irises or brush field spots. Ears tend to be small, little dysplastic and lightly lozenged. The nose, small nose with a flat nasal bridge is very marked. Next, when you see the mouth, they tend to have a small, short, hard palate, small teeth later, and also furrowed tongue. Now, facial part is over. Coming to the musculoskeletal part of it, we see the eye, hands and toes. When you see the hands of the child, you see the child is having a single palmar crease, and that is called as simian crease. We also notice that there is something called term called clinodactyly. What is that? It is a hypoplasia of the middle phalanx of the lifted fifth finger. So these two things are the hand features in Down syndrome, that is simian crease and clinodactyly. And when you see the toes, there is a wide gap between the first and the second toes, and that is called as the saddle gap. Down syndrome babies tend to have skin tics, the cutis marmorata, more often. Now let us see other associated features which are seen in case of Down syndrome. Associated anomalies or associated associations. First is CVS. Down syndrome children tend to have 40 to 60% children tend to have cardiovascular, congenital heart diseases. The congenital heart diseases mostly they are endocardial perfusion defects. Also, second ASDs, VSDs, TOF, pulmonary artery hypertension, and also aberrant subclavian arteries. So every child of Down syndrome, we have to have a cardiac evaluation of the child, including an echo, at least before 9 months of age. GIT. They have almost 12% more risk of atresias, especially due atresias. They have more risk of development of imperforate anus, annular pancreas, Hirschsprung's disease, tracheoesophageal fistulas, etc. In the years, it is found that these Down syndrome children tend to have more risk for conductive hearing loss. So, evaluate the child every at the time of we are diagnosing it, or at least in the first year, at least 2 times, and annually thereafter. After examination in the eyes, it is found that the children tend to have, like for example, 15% increased risk of nystagmus, 50% increased risk of refractory errors, cataracts, squints, etc. So we have to have a routine evaluation of the child at least annually for the eye examination. They have more risk for hypothyroidism, around 30 to 54% increased risk of hypothyroidism in kids with Down syndrome. So evaluate the child at neonatal period and at the 6 months of age, and also annually for the development of hypothyroidism. Later we may have to screen them for autoimmune hypothyroid disorders also. Now major another thing is atlantoaxial dislocation. This is very common in case of Down syndrome. So this babies require a lateral neck radiograph, both in flexion, extension, and also in neutral position. Every 3 to 5 years, or at the before surgery, or if any signs of cord compression comes, or they are before participating for any sports activities. This is the recommendation of my PG students and also for NEET aspirants. There is something called AVI, which is called atlanto-dense interval. That is the relationship between the dense and, or the C1-C2 relationship. We can know for this is atlanto-dense interval. So this is atlanto-dense interval, which shows us the relationship between the C1 and the C2. It's a distance between the dense and the C1. So in normal children, it is around 3 millimeters. In Down syndrome children, up to 4.5 millimeter is taken as normal, and anything up from 4.5 to 10 millimeter is taken as hyperextensibility, and more than 10 millimeter is taken as instability. So these are the ones. 3 is normal, 4.5 in Down it is normal, and at least more than 10 millimeter is taken as instability in a case of Down syndrome. And other associated things are also there. They have 15 to 20 times more risk of development of leukemia, especially ALL, AML, myelodysplasias, and transient myeloproliferative disorders. It is found that the children that have more tendency to develop leukemia, like acute megakaryocytic leukemias, where the GATA1 mutations are seen. So they are more prone to develop leukemia. So please screen them annually. Investigation should be done annually in the evaluation process of a Down syndrome child. Then what are the respiratory things seen associated with it? They have more chance of development of recurrent respiratory tract infection. They have more chance of obstructive sleep apneas and laryngotracheobronchomalacias, etc. So, and they tend to have, the coming to the growth, they tend to have slightly, tone increases or becomes better with age, but the developmental progression gets delayed as the child grows up. We monitor them for their growth and development and other associated behavioral abnormalities. When I ask tell about behavioral abnormalities, there are many things. Like they tend to be more stubborn. They generally have to tend to follow a routine. They are like, you know, most risk of development of autistic spectrum, and more risk, more chance of development of schizophrenia, and also early onset Alzheimer's disease. These children so have to be followed up closely. So in so many things. So when we see, when we understand associated features properly, now we can know how you should put a child of Down syndrome under follow up. What are to be important? First and foremost, please monitor the growth of the child, eyes, ears, thyroid profile, hemograms, developmental assessment, slightly bigger children, please screen for celiac disease and behavioral disorders. Mostly this, all this, and also cardiac evaluation. All these things are really important when our child to develop. Make sure when you plot the growth of a child, there are specific growth charts for Down syndrome babies available. The mortality mostly in case of Down syndrome is secondary to around congenital heart disease or leukemias. They tend to have a slightly lower risk of death due to ischemic heart disease or solid tumors. The average life expectancy is around 50 to 55 years. Now, coming to the recurrence, this is a very important part, because once a baby is having Down syndrome, once a mother is having a child with Down syndrome, the parents tend to be very anxious and they'll come and ask you, what is the risk that my next baby will have a Down syndrome? There, we need to know what is the karyotype, what is exactly genetics of the child with Down syndrome. If it is a translocation, as I already mentioned, if it is a T21-21 translocation, there is 100% risk of the next baby having the disease. And if the translocation is 14-21, the risk is only for, risk is for 5 to 7%. And also when you see a baby with translocation, we tend to evaluate the mother or the father with the karyotype, mother and father with the karyotype. If it is from the mother, translocation inherited from the mother, the risk is around 10%, whereas the risk inherited from the father, the risk decreases to around 5%. Now, we need to understand what can we do for such kids and how to screen for them in the future pregnancies. So, screening we tend to do with, and first trimester we can do a nuchal translucency test, which has got a decision rate of around more than 70%. If we can combine a nuchal translucency test with the maternal beta HCG and pregnancy associated plasma protein A, the decision rate rises up to around 87%. And in the second trimester, we have two tests. One is a quadruple test and one is a triple test. Triple test has a detection rate of around 70%, whereas quadruple test has a detection rate of around 80%. In the quadruple test, we see certain things like beta HCG, alpha fetoprotein, unconjugated estradiol, and inhibin A. If we can combine this first trimester NT scan with the biochemical profiles, we then have a detection rate around 97%, and this is what is an integrated scan, which is a more used nowadays. So, and other screening tests are using the amniocentesis and also gonadotropin. We can see it for the fetal DNA and find it out. So, whatever we have to think, we have to be very clear and careful, is Down syndrome children needs regular follow up. And what can we do for them? What treatment we can give? It's early stimulation, physiotherapies, and behavioral therapies we may have to give. For close evaluation of the child, and if behavioral disorders is treated, and other associated comorbidities also need to be treated. So that is in short given an overall idea about Down syndrome. And if you like it, please subscribe, and I will be coming up more short videos on important topics in pediatrics, which will help you understand the topic better. Thank you.